HyperPad's behavior system is one of the most important fundamentals you will need to learn to make apps and games on HyperPad. Behaviors are the building blocks that gives your projects functionality and a way for us to interact with it and get experience out of them. In this tutorial, I will break down everything that you will need to know about behaviors. I figured that I would prioritize this tutorial because I am seeing a lot of new users who are having a hard grasp on the behavior system. Considering that it's arguably the most important thing in HyperPad, again, this tutorial is out there for the sake of beginners. But for the people who are more experienced, you probably still want to watch this video because I see intermediate or even experienced users who make mistakes and false assumptions about the behavior system. So, let's dive into this bad boy! Woo! It's good to have enthusiasm.
Oh, Stephen Curry with the steal! Oh, juking and jiving! Oh, with the cheddar cheese balls! Oh my goodness! Oh, oh boy! Oh.
Alright, let's actually start. So, let's learn some vocabulary. This is a behavior. It looks like a block, and when you tap on it, it will open this behavior's input fields. Each behavior has their own input fields, where you can input text, numbers, objects, etc. If you don't know what a behavior does or how to use it, you can tap on this icon to see some written documentation and examples. But sometimes that might not help you. So you tap on this question icon, click manual, and go to whatever behavior you want to learn more about. There's also other useful resources, and this is actually where some of the information for this series comes from.
It's called research.
If you used HyperPad for quite a while, you've probably noticed that while selecting a behavior, green icons pop up from some other behaviors. These are output fields. You can tap and drag on them into an input field to use the output of that behavior. For example, let's say you had a behavior that added two numbers together and wanted to set a text object of the sum. You can drag the output of this behavior and put it in the input field of this behavior. Now, if we test the project, we can see that it worked. Well, what if you wanted to use multiple outputs for the same input field? That's easy! Next to some input fields, you can see a green icon on the left. You can tap on it, and it will prompt if you want to add it in or not. What this does is allow you to change that input field on the fly. The restart behavior toggle determines if it will trigger the behavior or not. For example, I want the input of set label to be the result of this behavior for this case. But in another case, I want to use a result of this behavior instead. For both of the set input field behaviors, I enabled restart behavior. So when the output field changes, the text changes even though this behavior is not connected to anything. Whee! That was a lot to take in. But practice makes perfect. Trust me, you learn fast if you try. Let's move on. There are different types of behaviors, and you will be able to tell by the icons denoted at the bottom of the connector circle thingies. Yeah, that's the best name I can think of. Connector circle thingies! Connector circle thingies! Really? I'm just gonna call them nodes. Yeah. You could just read the behavior reference, it tells you there too. The icons just tell you when and how the behavior will execute other behaviors. I know that sounds complicated, but I can assure you it is not. So let's just go over them. There are event behaviors, which are denoted by the lightning icon on the nodes below the behaviors. Event behaviors trigger other behaviors under it whenever something happens. For example, the started touching behavior executes behaviors below when an object has been touched. Touch as in your finger touching the screen and not other objects touching the object. Yeah, I remember being confused about that back then. I was so dumb, but hey, we learn. Some behaviors have a heartbeat icon, and this indicates that the behavior can execute multiple times at once or multiple times during an event. Despite the while touching behavior being an event behavior, technically it has a heartbeat icon because it can execute behaviors multiple times during an event. For example, while touching an object, it will keep executing other behaviors until you stopped touching it. Before we continue, we need to learn about the order of execution. Sometimes you would expect these behaviors to execute at the exact same time, but that's not technically the case. And I can prove it by just asking a simple question. Let's say we had two behaviors that changes a label. They execute at the same time. One of them will set the text to 0, and the other will set the text to 1. Now, if both of these behaviors are triggered at the same time in this behavior tree, yes, that's what we call them, behavior trees, what will be the resulting text in the end? Is it going to be 0? Is it going to be 1? It can't be both 0 and 1 at the same time. That doesn't make any sense. Okay, who thought neither was going to be a choice? What? Neither? In practice, only one behavior is executed at a time. So there's an order when it comes to executing multiple behaviors like this. Behaviors execute from top to bottom and left to right. Take a close look at this example. I will number the behaviors based on the order of execution. There are some exceptions to this rule, and that's involving the destroy object behavior and the disable object behavior. HyperPad is smart and assumes that you want all the behaviors in the same behavior tree to execute before destroying or disabling the object that the behaviors are in. Because when you destroy or disable an object, its behaviors are no longer accessible and cannot be executed. Instead, what happens is that HyperPad will intentionally execute these behaviors last. So if you did something like this, it will play a sound effect and then destroy itself. But if you really want to force behaviors to execute from left to right in the exact order that you want, which can be useful in some cases, then you will use the behavioral bundle behavior like so. Yep, that's pretty much all. All this behavior does is forcefully execute from left to right. It's also a nice organizational tool, so you can organize your behaviors like this. I just like it like that. But hey, do whatever you want with it, it helps. Okay, let me mention another simple but maybe overlooked rule. I know some HyperPad users have used Scratch before, and you may be familiar with having a block that starts executing your code. Well, in HyperPad, we don't have that. Behaviors not connected from the top will be executed right away when the project starts running. For event behaviors, that would just set them to be active so that they work. For instance, if there was a started touching behavior with nothing connected from the top, then that behavior will start working immediately. But if you execute an event behavior with another behavior before it, it will make that behavior active for only one execution. For example, if you connected a wait behavior to a started touching behavior, then the player will only be able to touch it once, and then the behavior isn't active anymore until executed once again. So, let's make sure that we understand this, using what we know so far. This wait behavior has no behavior connected from the top, and is not an event behavior, so it will execute when the project starts running. Alright, let's run this project. This behavior gets executed first, and then after a second, the started touching behavior is active. When the user taps on this object, it will play a sound effect, but it only happens once, because started touching is no longer active once touched. Alright, let's try another example. Let's just remove the wait behavior from the previous example. So, what happens now? The started touching behavior is not connected from the top anymore, but it is an event behavior, so it becomes active immediately when the project starts running. Every time the player taps on the object, it will play a sound effect. Unlike the previous example, the user is able to trigger the sound effect again by tapping on the object. Because the started touching behavior was not connected from the top, it is able to trigger other behaviors repeatedly. Got it? I can't tell if you're understanding all of this, but even if you don't, a lot of people learn through trial and error, so please do not stress yourself. As you have seen, HyperPad allows you to make behaviors execute one after another using a delay like this. Note that HyperPad doesn't wait to execute behaviors in the same behavior tree when using behaviors like this. The behaviors on the top will execute all at once, and the wait or timer behavior will do its thing uninterrupted. In the technical world, we would call this asynchronous processing. That means that multiple events in parallel can happen at once, at the same time. In Scratch, it would do one execution at a time, wait, do one execution at a time, wait, and so on. But in HyperPad, multiple of these processes can happen at once. Yes, I am aware that you can do this in Scratch, but it's a little more difficult. Notice that these behaviors have a clock as its node icon. That means that these behaviors will execute after a delay. There are a lot of behaviors that execute after a delay, and they work in the same way. Like move to object or rotate to angle. Recognize the clock icons? Yep, that means they trigger after a delay. Some behaviors have larger input fields like this. These input fields can be a sprite, an object, a behavior, a particle effect, or a sound effect, depending on what behavior you're looking at. I'm looking at the move to object behavior. According to the reference, it moves an object to another object. Sounds simple. You can tap on these larger input fields to select something. In this case, I'm selecting an object on my scene. So I select the first object and then my second object. Boom, it's that simple. So the first object will move to the second object in 1 second. Now, here's the important part. You can make the duration to be any number you like, and that number will be accounted for in behaviors that trigger after a delay. If you use a 0 second duration, it will execute other behaviors immediately. Alright, there's one more thing that you will need to know about behaviors. This button toggles this, and it determines if a behavior can be executed or not. If a behavior is off, it will be grayed out and it cannot be executed until enabled again. There are also behaviors to do this during runtime, which are called Behaviour On and Behaviour Off. For example, maybe you are making a story-based game and want to disable a behavior at a particular point. I don't know, there's a lot of scenarios where this becomes useful. And that concludes this video. That's all you need to know about the behavior system. If you have any questions, feel free to leave them in the comments below, but I'm more active in the HyperPad Discord server, so I recommend chatting there. I will make more videos in some particular behaviors that seem intermediate in the future. If time permits anyway. Well, I hope this video cleaned up some confusion and you learned a lot in this video. I will see you next time.
Bye! I'm not the one who's always right.